Okie dokie, back to condensation. We end this with fogs. Fog is a mass of suspended water droplets that forms a cloud that is in contact with the ground. So that's all fog is. Fog is just a cloud, something we've already studied, that's touching the ground. When it's in the sky, we call it a cloud. When it's on the ground, we call it a fog. That's it. If you were somehow able to go up into the sky where there's clouds and hang around up there without a machine, it would feel very much like being in a fog, because they are the same thing. In California, we have four versions of fogs. I'm going to talk about the first one right now, which is called advection fog. Advection fog is fog produced by the movement of relatively warm, moist air across a cold sea or land surface. By moist, I mean it has a high relative humidity. It's near saturation. By relatively warm, I mean this is in relationship to something else. 40 degrees is not warm, but it's warm compared to 30. That's what I'm talking about. There's a relationship, one in comparison to another. Advection fog is one in California we call our coastal fog, which is a fine name for it. It's the vernacular name, but the real scientific name for this is advection fog, which is the name I really want you to know. California is washed by a cold water current. If you consider the latitude of the state, the offshore environment is significantly warmer than the area right along the coastline. This is because that cold water current comes from the north. It comes from Alaska. Our latitude in Los Angeles is 34 degrees north. So we are much closer to the equator than we are to the North Pole, which means that our water should be more like the equator than the North Pole. But our water is coming from very, very far north, at least the water right along the coastline. And because of that, the water along the coastline is chilly. If you go to Huntington Beach, for example, during the winter and watch people surf, everybody's in a wetsuit because the water's cold. Even during the summer in California, if you go into the water at the beach, it tends to be chilly. And the further north you go, the chillier it becomes. Now, if you went straight across the country from Los Angeles to the East Coast, you'd be in South Carolina. It's not uncommon that the temperature can be 92 degrees in South Carolina, and you jump in the water, and the water's 90. It's not even pleasant. You sweat when you're in the water. Of course, on the East Coast, that warm water supports hurricanes. We don't get hurricanes on the West Coast, and the primary reason is because the water is just too cold for it. Take a look at this map. You can see California, San Francisco, Los Angeles, the LBC, Nevada, Las Vegas. California gets washed by this cold water current that flows down from Alaska south along the west coast of the United States. However, because of our latitude, the offshore environment, 50, 80, 100, 200 miles offshore, the water is a temperature that is more reflective of what our latitude is, which means the water is 6, 8, 10 degrees even warmer out there than it is right along the coastline, because that water is coming from Alaska that's along the coastline. We sit in California most days under a westerly wind flow, which means the air flows from west to east. And of course, to the west of us is the Pacific Ocean. Now, if you look at those arrows I drew on there, you can see the arrowheads are touching the land, but the back end of the arrows are out there in that warm water. And the air takes on the characteristics of whatever it is over. So the air that sits out there over those warm pools of water that sit offshore, that air becomes warm and wet, meaning high relative humidity. Then it gets caught in that westerly wind flow, and as it moves towards the coastline, drags across that cold water current. And remember, because the air takes on the characteristics of whatever it's over, when air temperature goes up, relative humidity goes down, and when air temperature goes down, relative humidity goes up. That's rule number two. I created this diagram for you. You can see on the right-hand side land, that's the state of California. Then right along the coastline, you can see cold water. And then out in the ocean, further out, the offshore environment, you can see warm water. That air starts out over that warm water, So the air itself is warm and wet, meaning high relative humidity. Then it gets caught in those westerly winds and slowly moves towards the land. As it does that, the air drags over the top of the cold water current, and that cold water cools the air. As the air temperature goes down, relative humidity goes up. And as the air temperature goes down and the relative humidity goes up, at some point, if the air temperature reaches the dew point temperature, the relative humidity will be 100%. At that point, the air is saturated and water will begin to squeeze out. What does it squeeze out onto? All of those salt crystals that are floating around in the air. Remember, salt acts as the primary condensation nucleus. And by the coastline, 75% of the planet is covered with salt water. By the coastline in California, you can smell the salt in the air. And the result is that when the water squeezes out, it squeezes out around all of those salt crystals. So as the air temperature drops to the dew point temperature, the relative humidity is 100%, the air is saturated, and the advection fog forms. And then it blows in. Now, this is typically going to happen late in the evening, early in the morning. How and where does that fog burn off first and last? So burn off means the fog is going to dissipate. Can you guess where this is going to happen? All you have to do to make the fog go away is raise the air temperature by 1 degree. Because remember, in order to have 100% relative humidity and the air being saturated, air temperature and dew point temperature must be the same number. So if you can raise the temperature, the air temperature by 1 degree, air temperature and dew point temperature will no longer be the same number, and the relative humidity will drop below 100%. The air will no longer be saturated. The water will still be in the air. The specific humidity is still the same. But it's like taking a 12-ounce glass filled with water and then pouring that water into a 16-ounce glass. The 16-ounce glass is not 100% full. So if you just raise the temperature a little bit, the fog will dissipate. And what happens is when the sun comes up, inland areas are going to heat up first. This is the continental effect. They're going to absorb shortwave radiation, and the ground's going to begin to get warm. And as the ground gets warm, the ground will let out long-wave radiation. When it does, that will raise the temperature of the air that's in contact with the ground. And that will cause the fog to lift. So the way it burns back is, or burns off, the way it dissipates is inland up. Inland up. So it pushes the fog back towards the coastline, which is going to be the last area to heat up because of the maritime influence. I was flying into LAX or Long Beach, I forget which one it was, about a year ago. This is over Malibu. And as we were coming closer and dropping down in elevation over the Pacific Ocean and coming towards the coastline in California, I saw this beautiful advection fog that was right along the coastline. If you look at it carefully, the arrow's pointing at it. If you were driving along PCH in Malibu, you would be in a fog. But you can see that just offshore, it's much clearer because the air is flowing in, it's going right over that current, and when it does, bang, the air temperature drops to the dew point temperature, relative humidity is 100%, air is saturated, and the fog forms. Earlier in the summer, I had been driving back from Pismo Beach, and we were in Ventura, and this perfect advection fog was going across the 101, the freeway. And I was grabbing my phone to try and take pictures of this because it was just so perfect. It was just flowing right across the freeway. There it was, exactly as it is supposed to do. Now, this picture, which I showed you with regard to albedo, you can see the sun is setting, is also taken in Central California. If you look offshore, you can see the fog. So what happens is this, the sun's setting, so we're getting closer to the sun going down and temperatures being able to drop. But during the day when the sun is up, the land heats up. And when the land heats up, it's not as if the heat from the land reaches exactly at the coastline right where the waves are breaking and no heat energy gets projected offshore. There's heat energy from the land that gets projected offshore during the day. And what that does is it shoves the fog back because the temperature is going up. And you can see about how far it does it. In the case of when this picture was taken, the fog's about 1 mile offshore. There it is out there. But then when the sun comes down, what's going to happen is that heat energy from the land is going to diminish. And when it does, the fog will then slowly roll back in and cover the coastline. Then the sun comes up the next day and it pushes it back. And there's this constant back and forth that's going on.